CSN International presents To Every Man an Answer, the live apologetics program that equips you to give a reason for the hope that lies within you.
If you have a Bible question or a question on the Christian faith, you can call us at 1-888-827-5276. Again, that's 1-888-ASK-CSN.
Let's get things started. Here's today's host, Mike Kestler.
Hi, and welcome to Tuesday's edition of To Every Man an Answer. We're glad you've joined us. Looking forward to being with you for about the next hour. We set this time aside every weekday afternoon to answer questions about the Bible from the Bible, look at current events from a biblical perspective. And what we hear in church, is it even in the Bible at all? Well, if you got a question, that number to call again, 888-ASK-CSN, toll free. We got some lines open right now, so if you call right now, you're assured to get on. Again, 888-ASK-CSN. Joining us today, special guest, featured CSN speaker that comes on 1 hour before To Every Man an Answer, John Randall from Calvary Chapel, South OC by San Clemente, California. Hi, and welcome.
Hey, Mike, great to be back with you on this Tuesday. God bless you.
Blessings to you. It's always a blessing to be on with you. I look forward to Tuesdays, and so it's always great to have you with us. John, what's happening in Southern California?
Well, we are into the summer months, my friend. Things are going well. We just had another baptism this last weekend down here in Dana Point Harbor, and we had a lot of people going into the water, Mike. And, you know, I did something this week that I hadn't done before. And of course, we give people opportunity before we go to the water to share why they're being baptized, why they've chosen to identify with Christ. And so some people will come up and speak into the mic. But then this time when we came out to the water, I just felt impressed to ask people who were being baptized, why are you here? And it was amazing to hear their response, Mike, just the testimonies of people choosing to identify with Jesus and why they were doing it. It was very moving. And I think it was good for them to hear themselves say it and then to go into the water and come out in that newness of life. It was just it's a great way to end a Sunday evening.
Amen. You know, it's really funny because I think a lot of times in things spiritual, things religious, I think a lot of people just start doing things. They don't even know why they're doing what they're doing. Mm-hmm. You know, when you talk to people, in their liturgical prayers, you know, think they're being heard for their much speaking. Mm-hmm. And we don't really know why we do it. And I'm amazed how many years you can spend as a devout Christian and still not really understand what we do. Like many people with the bread in communion, mm-hmm. That is for your healing. Peter said, by his stripes, we are healed. Jesus's body was broken so that you could be healed. Now, again, we're very complex beings. We have a body, a mind, and a spirit, and any one of those can be amiss. You'll find people all the time that jump off bridges in perfect health. Why? Because they're sick inside. But this is what I believe Jesus came to do in the communion, in first of all, that he died for us, his blood covered our sins, and we're now born again. But then there's a healing that goes on every day that we need from him. Mm. Many, many years, I was a Christian. I understood the bread was Jesus's body, but I never really understood why it was so important. We need to get separated from our past really bad. We need to forgive ourselves. We need to ask God to forgive us. And then understanding that forgiveness is there and not letting the devil throw our past in our face, those deep wounds, we need to be healed. And so that body, mind, and spirit, all three, I believe, are covered there when Jesus spoke of, by his stripes, we are healed. Let's go to the phones. We have Dustin on the line in the Dallas, Texas. Hi, welcome.
Hi there, Mike.
Hi, how may we help?
In Matthew chapter 23, it says, for the Pharisees shall receive the greater damnation. Mm-hmm. What exactly are the Pharisees?
Well, the Pharisees are ones that professed something, but they didn't practice what they preached. Jesus said, don't be like the Pharisees when it comes to prayer. He says, two men went up to the temple to pray. One, a Pharisee, another, a tax collector. The Bible says that the Pharisee said, God, I thank you, I'm not like everybody else. I tithe, I do this, I do that. And then the tax collector, the publican, said, God be merciful to me, a sinner. He wouldn't even look up, and he beat on his chest. Jesus said, I tell you, he's the one that went away right with God, not the other. Your thoughts, John?
Yeah, the Pharisees, they were, you know, Jesus had more problems with the religious group than he did with the sinners.
Anybody.
Yeah, and the sinners, you know, they responded, many of them. Jesus said, I came to call not the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Jesus was the physician for those that recognize they need a healing. Of course, the Pharisees were that religious group, and they were very well-versed in the law of God. They spent their life studying it. They were really supposed to be the shepherds of God's people. Unfortunately, rather than shepherd God's people and feed them, they placed severe burdens on the people, things that they were traditions, Dustin, that they added to God's word itself. In fact, Jesus rebuked them, and he said that they held their traditions even above the word of God, making the word of God of no effect. That's why when Jesus would perform a particular miracle or heal on the Sabbath, they were constantly criticizing what he was doing, primarily because he was breaking with man-made tradition. And although they knew the scriptures and although they knew God, they did not glorify him. And so because of that, they were going to have a greater, because of what they knew and what they, the biblical knowledge that they have, a greater condemnation. So these people, unfortunately, they search the scriptures. Jesus said, you search the scriptures, for in them you think that you have eternal life, but they are those which testify of me. And unless you become like a little child, you'll not enter the kingdom. Furthermore, Jesus said to his disciples in the Sermon on the Mount, unless your righteousness goes beyond the man-made righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you're never going to see heaven.
So very serious. Hope that helps.
Yes. So say, for instance, I doubt you ever would. So say, for instance, you decide to turn your back on God. Would you also receive the greater damnation just like the Pharisees? Because clearly you know way more about the scripture than I do. So would that term apply to you as well?
Well, the Bible says, to whom much is given, much is expected. And so I believe that we have to give an account of what we do with our relationship with God. Now, that's not to say that in all of our lives, whether you're a pastor, whether you're not a pastor, you don't have hard times and dry times in your Christian experience. But I do believe that there's always that heart for God that, wow, God, forgive me, I'm sorry. But the Pharisees didn't have that. They thought they had arrived. And oftentimes they'd say to Jesus, our father Abraham said or taught us, or Moses said. And not what God meant to them personally, but that they were referencing an inherited kind of a relationship with God. So I believe that any person that knows God will have to give an account of what they did with their relationship with God. Now, if a person backslides, even as a pastor, and I've known many in my life, I just trust the Holy Spirit to bring them home. God has a way of getting somebody's attention. It may be very hard. It's such as the case with God's hand on Samson's life. It took him to be blinded and walking around and around in circles before he got his heart fixed back on calling upon God again. I believe that all of us need to be and take our relationship very seriously with God, not thinking that it's anything that I generated in myself, but rather what God has in his love blessed us with and clothed us with his righteousness. I think that's so important. John, any last thoughts?
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, Dustin, that particular passage now, Matthew 23:14, Jesus is saying, woe, scribes and the Pharisees, to you because you're hypocrites, and which means you're a pretend, you're a fake, you're a play actor.
Poser.
Yeah, you devour, notice this is what he says, you devour widows' houses, and then for a pretense, you make long prayers. Therefore, you will receive the greater condemnation. I mean, think about somebody who is so vulnerable, a widow, And here they come in, and they're going to take advantage of her. And then just to kind of make everything look like they're really taking care of her, they're going to make a long prayer. But in reality, they have a hidden agenda. Jesus said, listen, you are using your position to take advantage of the most vulnerable. Oh, there's definitely a greater condemnation for those that would do that. So he's calling out those who they were fake to begin with, and yet they knew better. But they were taking advantage of the vulnerable. And he said, listen, you're going to be held accountable for that. So that is what that, in that context of that verse that you're asking, Matthew 23:14, it would apply to.
So I hope that helps.
Yes, it did. So the Pharisees was just a term for that day. So we have those people all over the place right now, all over the radio, all over these massive, extravagant churches. We have those same people. They're just not called Pharisees today.
Yeah, well, you know, it's funny. There's a book called Fox's Book of Martyrs, and it tells you how the early church fathers died, how the disciples died. But one thing that's not in the Fox's Book of Martyrs is how the Pharisees died. It's because they didn't. They're still here. So any last thoughts, John?
No, I just think, hey, listen, Jesus gave so many warnings to the Pharisees, and he made a constant comparison, especially in the Sermon on the Mount, in Matthew chapters 5 through 7, for his disciples. You know, he would say, you've heard that it's been said, and then he'd say, but I say to you. So there has to be a difference between us and that Pharisaical kind of living, Dustin. I think you've made that correlation, and you're accurate. We don't want to be like that. We want to be like Jesus, and so it's important that we don't play the hypocrite.
Amen. Best to be about our daddy's business. Hope that helps.
It does. It does help a lot. Thank you.
Dustin, Sam Lyon, send you out some books, some DVDs, the movie Jesus. Great for evangelism. If you need more, just let me know. Stay online. We'll get you fixed up. Let's go to Sarah. Hi and welcome. Sparks, Nevada. Sarah, are you there?
Hello. Sorry. So my question was today, whenever Jesus was a little kid, did he ever meet his Aunt Elizabeth?
Well, the Bible, I don't believe, tells us, but I would suppose so, because back then, everybody, it was a pretty tight-knit community. John, your thoughts?
Yeah, I would believe, you know, although it doesn't say specifically, and by the way, Sarah, are you 10 years old?
Yes.
Well, that is an amazing question that you ask.
It is.
And I just want to thank you for calling with that question, Sarah, and listening. You know, although it doesn't say that Jesus met Elizabeth, I would not be surprised if they did. One passage of scripture that came to mind is in Luke's gospel, chapter 2, in verses 41 through 51. And that talks about when Jesus went up to Jerusalem with his parents for Passover. And when they were making their way up, Jesus at that time, well, he was 12 years old. And they went as was their usual celebration. And usually they would travel as a family together. And you remember it says there that when Mary and Joseph left, they thought, it says they couldn't find Jesus. They thought he was with their relatives and their friends, but actually he wasn't. He was in the temple. I think Jesus normally, they would travel together and they would meet up as friends and they would celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles. They would celebrate the Passover together. So yes, I do believe that they would have met, although it doesn't say it in the Bible. I think it's safe to assume that these family relations and these family ties were really important. And so they would see each other maybe even once a year. Maybe, Sarah, like when you get together with your grandma and your grandpa if they live in another place and you get your family together that you don't see every year but you see on special occasions, it wouldn't surprise me if Jesus had actually met Elizabeth. Although we do know that the Bible does say when Mary came to Elizabeth and she was pregnant, that Elizabeth said the baby inside of her jumped. It was John the Baptist. And she said, how is it that the mother of my Lord has come to visit me? So I think they did see each other at some point in Jesus's life growing up.
Amen. And by the way, probably there's not a better verse than when the baby leaped, that proves that babies are real people and shouldn't be killed. Sarah, I hope that helps, dear.
Yes, thank you.
Hey, I want to send you the movie Jesus and a couple other things, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Well, Sarah, you keep reading your Bible and keep asking questions, and we're always here if you got another question. So you call us anytime. Stay in line, and I'll make sure you get some books and some DVDs. Let's go to Carol, Florence, Oregon. Hi, welcome.
Hi. Thanks for taking my call. It's about, my question is about 2 Peter 1:20. Know this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. And the way I understand this verse, which I don't know if it's right or not, the prophecy would be from the prophets, the book of the prophets, and it was for a certain purpose, only that purpose, and not for us today. And so, and they would be Old Testament. So is that correct?
Well, dear, there is a lot of prophecy in the Old Testament. And when the Hebrews would read scripture, they would read it with three perspectives. They would read it for obviously what it says. They would read it for the spiritual application and then the future application. Now, the Bible says it's alive, sharper than any two-edged sword. I believe that just because it doesn't have a heart beating and veins and corpuscles and all, doesn't mean that it's not alive. And I believe that's why when we read the Bible, that Holy Spirit that wrote this book speaks to our heart through his word. And if you read the next verse, sheds a little more light on it. I'll just read both verses together, 20 and then 21. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of scripture is of any private interpretation. Now here's the answer. For prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. So that would not say then that it's only limited, but it's that we have to be careful, because a lot of times people will try to twist what the prophecy says, but it's very clear what it says. Such as an example, in Revelation chapter 13, the Bible says during the tribulation period, you'll not be able to buy or sell without the mark, name, or number on your hand or on your forehead. And yet it's interesting. People say, oh no, that's not what it means. It means worshiping on Sunday or some other bizarro interpretation. That's where I believe this is where we get into trouble with private interpretation. Rather than does it fit the rest of Scripture, does it fit what the Holy Spirit has been saying? Your thoughts, John.
Well, I love the fact that, you know, right now in church, Mike and Carol, so thankful for the call. You know, you'll find that throughout the Bible, right now we're in the Gospel according to Matthew, and Matthew will consistently go back and he will say, all this was done that the scriptures might be fulfilled. And he'll pull from some prophetic passage out of Isaiah or some other place or the Psalms to tie it in to what Jesus was doing at that particular moment. You also see this in Luke's gospel. You see it in Mark's gospel. You find it even in the book of Acts. You remember when Peter, or when the Bible says in Acts chapter 1, brethren, the scriptures had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit foretold by the mouth of David. I mean, Peter's pulling back and he's looking at prophetic scripture and he's interpreting what's happening through and tying it together. So biblical prophecy is, by the way, one of the things that sets the Bible apart from every other book, religious book that's out there. Jesus fulfilled, it's estimated, over 300 prophecies in his lifetime. 300! And you look at it and you think, how does a person determine, Mike, where they're going to be born, the death they're going to die before it's ever created, how many pieces of silver, the city they're going to grow up in, the timing in which they're going to be born? I mean, it's overwhelming to see these passages written hundreds, sometimes thousands of years before, being fulfilled in the person and work of Jesus. Prophecy is so powerful. It sets the Bible apart, and I think it's important for us to recognize the significance of it. And I know for us, every time, Mike, that we come to it in the Bible, we point it out. You know, another way, another translation of that passage, 2 Peter 1:20 says this. It says, above all, you must realize that no prophecy in Scripture ever came from the prophet's own understanding. They were moved by God. God put it upon them, and then they spoke it as they were moved by the Holy Spirit.
Hope that helps.
A little. It's still hard, not totally clear in my mind, but.
Well, John, how would you reword that to be able to settle it? Because, you know, now let me ask you this, Carol. Is it that someone has told you that the prophecies in the Bible happened a long time ago and there's nothing else going on today? Is that what someone's told you?
No, what someone told me was that a certain piece of prophecy in Jeremiah was for me. And I want it, if it's only a private interpretation, then it'd only be for whoever Jeremiah's talking to, not me. Is that correct?
Well, you know, like I say, I don't know who said this to you. I don't know if it was a word from the Lord or this person that told this to you had gas and indigestion. I don't know. But I know that when a word from the Lord generally motivates us to go deeper with him. If I can ask, what did they say this? Can I ask you what they were saying?
I'd like to tell you, but it's been so long ago, but that every time I read that scripture, I, like I told her, that that can't be for me because prophecy's only not for private interpretation. And so that's where my understanding is, but my understanding may not be correct.
Well, it is possible that verses in the Bible do apply to us. I don't think it's only just for you, but God knowing humanity and God knowing that there is no trial that is foreign to God, that he doesn't understand or get, that hasn't been tried by somebody else. The Word of God was written to encourage us and to bring us into check and to motivate us and all these different things. And sometimes there's a verse that just fits very nicely. On the other hand, I've had people come up and say things, what the Bible says, and it was out of context. It was not of the Holy Spirit. It was them being mean or vindictive. And so I realized that that is not. So we have to be real careful sometimes of the God told me to tell you, or this verse is for you. You know, I mean, somebody could come up and say, this verse is for you. Judas hung himself, you know, or something. Yeah, I mean, something weird like that. It doesn't mean that God had anything to do with that. Any last thoughts, John?
Yeah, I was thinking of some examples, Carol. Let me give you one example. Let's think of the prophet Isaiah. Now, listen to this word that Isaiah speaks. Isaiah says, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed. I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Isaiah 41:10. I receive that. I take hold of that. The word of God is written for our admonition, both Old Testament and New Testament. I take hold of that word. That's not private interpretation. That's me saying, God, I hear what you say. I receive it. I'm not going to be afraid. You are with me. You've told that to me both in Old and New Testament. I take hold of that passage. Now, granted, that's one that you could grab onto. That's Isaiah the prophet speaking a promise of God. You can hold on to that. But if it's some random verse that, you know, says God's going to give you land in Israel or something out of, like Mike said, some strange aberrant verse that doesn't line up, then that's different. But we can take hold of all, the Bible says that all God has given us everything that pertains to life and godliness and exceedingly great and precious promises, the Bible says, have been given to us, both found in Old Testament and New Testament. And I take hold of those and I receive them and live according to them.
And what he means by take hold of those promises, those verses in the Bible do apply to us.
Yeah, I believe them.
So, and we believe that. So hope that helps.
That's good. Yeah, that really helped. That really got to it finally. Thank you so much.
Well, Carol, good. I'm glad the burden is gone. So yeah. Stay in line. We'll send you out some books, DVDs. We're here for you if you got any more questions, okay?
Thank you so much. God bless you.
God bless you, Carol. I'm so glad you called, and you'll really like the movies I'll send you. So God bless you, dear. Let's go to Dan, San Jose.
Hi, pastors. I love you. I appreciate you. I had a question about family Bible reading. So I've been reading to my kids the Bible since, you know, they're 14 and 11 now, and since they were young. And I feel like it's just become, you know, too familiar to them, or, you know, they kind of have contempt for it. And I'm just looking for some recommendations to kind of spice it up. I mean, we try to live out the gospel in our house the best we can. But it's just become kind of like, I want them to read the Bible on their own, really. I want them to love the Bible on their own. But, you know, do you have any recommendations?
Well, of course, you know, the Bible's good to read. There's some Bible versions out there, like the picture Bible, it's almost done like a comic book, but it's real. And the Holy Spirit speaks through it. I've read it and I go, wow, this is really good. But it's all illustrated and it looks like something you'd see in a comic book, but it's the whole Bible. It's called the Action Bible. And you might want to check that out. You can look at them online or whatever. But very, very unique. It's called the Action Bible, primarily targeted for probably kids under 15. Very good. Your thoughts, John?
Well, Dan, I just want to commend you, brother, for being a spiritual leader in your home.
Yes.
And reading the Word of God to your kids. And, you know, my wife and I, we have raised 4 children, and some of our kids are now raising their own kids. And, you know, as a dad raising 4 children and trying to do devotions, sometimes it was really challenging. And I feel like sometimes I'd be correcting them, like, listen to what I'm, and devotions turned into correction. And it just, sometimes it didn't work. But we're going to be right back. I've got some insight on how to share the word with your kids. And I think you'll be encouraged.
Yes, as John's got a lot of kids, so I'm sure he has a lot of good things to say, and I want to hear this too. Coming upon that break, we'll be having more right after this. We'll be right back.
Thank you for listening to CSN Radio, where God's word is heard. Did you know your financial support is a primary reason we can broadcast over 400 stations nationwide? It's true. We are grateful for your partnership. As you know, our nation is battling over religious and civil freedoms. Here at CSN Radio, our listeners can trust us to be a solid biblical teaching foundation and share a Christian perspective on current times. The importance of reaching the masses is greater than ever. We need your support in this uncertain time of chaos and strife. We are excited to share that we plan to add more stations in 2023 and 2024. This means we will reach more of the lost, broken, and deceived. Mark 16, verse 15 quotes Jesus. He said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation." We need your support in funding the building of these new stations. You can go to csnradio.com/donate or call 1-800-357-4226. That's csnradio.com/donate or call us at 1-800-357-4226.
Even when I'm lost, you take my hand.
Edifying the saints and evangelizing the world. Great Bible teaching. Equipping a worshiping church. This is CSN International.
We want to welcome you back to part two of Jeremy and Matt Answer here on this Tuesday afternoon with John Randall. I'm your host, Mike Kestler, and we're going to go right back to the phones because, you know, really, ministering to your children, I believe, is probably one of the hardest things to do, John. And Dan is being a good dad, trying to do his best. Your thoughts?
Yeah, again, Dan, just commend you for raising those kids in the Lord. That's a huge responsibility, especially in this world, and praise God for what you're doing. You know, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 7, it says, "You shall teach them diligently," talking about the precepts of God's word, "to your children. Talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down and when you rise up." You know, this really ministered to me when my kids were little, because sometimes I'd want to sit them down and say, all right, I'm going to read to you. Let's open to Leviticus. Well, probably not Leviticus, but I'm going to read them the scriptures. I'd read them the Bible stories. Sometimes they just didn't seem to be getting it. As they got a little bit older, it seemed like they didn't want to hear it. But you know what? We kept after it. We continued to sow the word of God. Whether we were driving in the car, whether we were at a baseball game and I was coaching the kids, I would be instilling biblical values into my boys as they were playing. If I was taking my daughter to the park and pushing her on the swing, I'd be talking to her about Jesus. I'd be talking to her about, hey, why don't you go talk to that person and tell them about, I mean, there's just everything we did, our life. We go to the grocery store, let's talk about Jesus. So in other words, the devotional life and getting my kids turned on to Jesus was just living it in front of them and continuing to sow the seed of the word of God. Sometimes in right before they went to bed, we'd pray together, we'd read the word together. And what I want to say to you is just keep on doing it. And the reason why I say that is because God says in his word in Isaiah, "My word that goes forth from my mouth, it shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please. It shall prosper the thing for which I send." And so I'd say to you, Dan, and all those other parents that wonder, is it worth it? You know, so much of what we're doing with our kids when they're little is we're just sowing. We're sowing, we're watering, we're sowing. And you know what? As we are faithful to do that, Dan, you're going to reap that in your kids. There's going to come a day when those kids are going to walk with Jesus, and they're going to come to that age where they understand what it means. They're going to be so thankful that our dad chose to read us the word of God. Nothing more important. No greater legacy or heritage can you pass on to your children than Jesus. And man, just keep at it, you know, and that's awesome, man.
Amen. So I hope that helps.
Yeah, thank you, brothers. God bless you guys.
Yeah, you might want to check out the Action Bible. It's something your kids might really like. I'll send you some books, some DVDs that might also spark their interest a little bit. God of Wonders, and certainly Evolution versus God is really good to sit down and watch with them. Because, see, what happened, and I think this is something we all have to understand concerning probably, if you're probably under 30 years old, the school systems of America changed the way they educated. Before, we were taught how to think. Now you're told what to think. And you say, well, what's the difference? Everything. What to think is evolution is true. America is bad. Communism is good. This is what our kids are taught in school. You're taught what to think. Now, how to think is different. How to think is evolution is questionable because you don't have the transitional or the transitory life forms. You don't have enough time of the millions of years they need for evolution to take place. You look at the other facts, the diameter of the sun shrinking every year. You go back the number of billions of years they need for evolution. You got the diameter of the sun out, you know, out by Mars. There's a lot of things like that. That's how to think. America is bad. Well, they only point out the failures of America. They don't rarely ever point out the successes. Like, for instance, the whole world would be Germany right now if it wasn't in Japan, if it wasn't for the United States. But they don't talk about that. They talk about how bad the atomic bomb was on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, how cruel we were. They didn't talk about the surprise attack on December 7th, 1941, when the sailors were asleep and getting bombed into the stratosphere. They don't talk about that. See, that's how to think. But when you're taught what to think, you have no reasonable ability to put things together. Now, it's interesting. They keep saying, we need more money. The school boards need more money. Well, what's really amazing, in all the money they have been given, the SAT scores are the lowest they've ever been. Because you see, what to think doesn't work. You have to know how to think. And our kids are the same way, and especially when it comes to Christianity. They're bombarded by saying the Bible is a big book of myths, a lot of stories, Genesis cannot be true, never mind how untrue evolution is, and that evolution at its very best is nothing more than a religion based on nothing, because there's no facts for it. Nothing. This is the problem. And so our kids are bombarded with this, and we don't think it affects our Christian children growing up in a Christian home, but it does, because they're bombarded with it on 5 days a week, all day long in their schools for years and years and years, and it begins to affect them. So we have to understand what our poor kids are being subjected to. And now, from transgenderism to all this other insane stuff going on, our poor kids are it's a battle for their soul. So Dan, I want to just commend you heartily for keeping the good fight and doing your very best. And anything and everything we can do to keep the gospel from becoming mundane, I believe, is so important. The relevancy of the gospel is, to me, the most important thing that any Christian, young or old, can grasp. The relevancy. It is not an old book written thousands of years ago that has nothing to do with today. As you read prophecy, it knows more about tomorrow than we remember about yesterday. And so I just want to encourage you. I'll send you some things I think your kids will like. And stay in line. We'll get you fixed up, okay?
All right. Thank you very much. God bless you guys. Keep you strong. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name, Dan. You stay on. We'll get that out to you. Let's go to Scott, Charleston, South Carolina. Hi, welcome.
Hey, yes, thank you for taking my call. Been studying through the book of Galatians, and yes. It talks about the those who are of faith are the sons of Abraham. And I was having a discussion with a coworker, and we were talking about this idea, and then we talked about Genesis 12, where God made a promise to Abraham and his descendants, and he would bless those that bless him and curse those that curse him. And so we got into the topic of the nation of Israel today. And my coworker said, well, Israel now is just another nation. They're no different than anybody else because of what Christ accomplished on the cross, fulfilling the promise or the covenant with Abraham. And I was like, I don't know about that. I think Israel is still a special nation, but he disagrees. And I just wanted to get your opinion on that.
Well, my opinion doesn't matter, but the Word of God does. And if you bring him to Luke chapter 21, Jesus said this concerning the nation of Israel. No other nation on earth does he mention like this. Jerusalem will be trodden down by the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles is fulfilled. The nation of Israel is under Jewish control. The city of Jerusalem is under, the complete city is under Jewish control. They got half the city in 1948. They got the other half of the city in 1967. About 3 years ago, Donald Trump declared to the world that Jerusalem was the capital of Israel. I believe that, again, this is extremely important, because then the book of Revelation will not make any sense. Now they say, well, the book of Revelation happened in 70 AD. Oh, really? You mean every living thing in the sea died in 70 AD? Well, that was metaphorically speaking, they'll say. Well, metaphorically or non-metaphorically, nothing even like that remotely happened to the sea. The Bible is very clear, and the book of Revelation is not a book of metaphors. Now, obviously, when you talk about a beast with 7 heads and 10 horns, yeah, that's a metaphor. But when it talks about every living thing in the sea dying, it means every living thing in the sea dead. When the Bible talks about 1/4 of the world's population is dead in just the very first part of the tribulation period, which would by right now be about 2 billion people. That's not metaphorically speaking. When the Bible says God selects out of the tribes of Israel 144,000 Jews, 12,000 from each tribe, and just so no cult can mess it up, it lists the tribes by name, yet the cults still mess it up. Because it's metaphorically speaking. All of a sudden, everything's metaphorically. I mean, how do we know that air is not metaphorical? I mean, this is the level of poor exegesis of the scripture that you get. But when you realize the Bible says 144,000 male Jews from the 12 tribes of Israel and lists them by name, that is not metaphorical. Why would the nation of Israel be cited if God was done with the nation of Israel? In fact, we find all the way through the Bible, God has never been done with the nation of Israel. What you're running into here, Scott, I believe, is you've come across somebody into what's called replacement theology, that the church has replaced Israel. The promises that were for Israel now pertain to the church, and God has no more to do with Israel than he does with Peru. It simply shows an extremely poor understanding of God's word. And I don't mean to be rude here, but I'm saying that you have to tamper. You have to change God's word. Read Revelation 22, what happens to people who change the book of Revelation into metaphorically speaking. Oh man, I'll tell you something. I don't want to be in that number. Very clear. Your thoughts, John?
You know, a great passage of scripture, Scott, to go to is in the book of Romans, chapter 11. And Paul asked the very question that we're asking right now. Paul said this in chapter 11, verse 1. He said, I say then, has God cast away his people? And then he answers it by saying, certainly not. So there you can start right there and say, no, God hasn't cast away his people. And then Paul goes on to give examples of this. He said, well, for one thing, I'm a descendant of Abraham. So if God was done with his people, I wouldn't be here. And then he goes on to describe in Israel's history how that God has always had a remnant. You know, so many of the prophecies that were made to Israel and that were given to Abraham, we see throughout the scriptures, but there's also many prophecies that have yet to be fulfilled concerning the nation of Israel. So he hasn't cast them away. God has always had a plan for Israel. Of course, there is one body. There is Gentile and Jew, neither Jew nor, they were all one in Christ. We get that. But that doesn't mean that the promises that God made to Israel are suddenly null and void, even though they are one body. God does still have a plan for them. And in fact, the Bible tells us in the tribulation, one of the reasons for the tribulation period is to bring the Jewish people back to their Messiah. They are going to come to the realization of who Jesus is. Many who have turned away will come back. A couple other passages, I would say Psalm 94, verse 14, when it says, the Lord will not abandon his people, nor will he forsake his inheritance. And then, of course, in Psalm 89, verse 31, even if they break my statutes and don't keep my commandments, then I will visit their transgressions with a rod and their iniquity with stripes. Nevertheless, my loving kindness, I will not, notice that, not utterly take away from him, nor allow my faithfulness to fail, nor my covenant to break, nor alter the word that's gone from my lips. Even though they have failed, God will not fail. He will fulfill his promise that he made. It's just a matter of time.
Hope that helps.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time.
Yeah, go just, you like I say, simply, if God's done with the nation of Israel, then why does Jesus use Jerusalem as a time marker for the end of the age? Because Jesus goes on and says in 21 that he says that that Jerusalem will be trodden down by the Gentiles till the time of the Gentiles is fulfilled. And then he goes on and says, and the generation that sees this will not pass away till they're all fulfilled. That's the end. And so there is a missing 7-year period of time of God directly dealing with his nation of Israel. In the 69th week, we read in Daniel 9, Messiah was cut off. In that 70th week, that 7 final year period of time, we call the tribulation period, God does 2 things. He deals directly with his nation of Israel. And number 2, he deals with a God-rejecting world. And then Jesus sets up his millennial reign here on this earth for 1,000 years. And so, Scott, stay on the line, send you out some books, some DVDs I think will be helpful for you. And we're here for you if you get any more questions, okay?
Thank you very much.
God bless you. Let's go to William in Powell, Tennessee, I believe it is. Hi, welcome.
Hey, I pulled up a couple of verses. What I was saying is it Paul's gospel? I mean, because he literally said my gospel in Romans 2:16. Like, he said my gospel six times in the New Testament. Is it Paul's gospel or is it Christ's gospel?
Well, it's God's gospel, but Paul is not operating on his own. He's a direct representative sent by God to the Gentiles. So I believe this is why he was talking about his gospel. And we can say that as well. My gospel, it's God's gospel. I don't have anything in myself. Your thoughts, Scott? Or excuse me, John?
The word gospel, by the way, it means good news. And there's a lot of people out there with a false gospel. There's people preaching the wrong gospel. So when Paul says my gospel, it would be implied. It's a good question that you ask, William. And I think you're really thinking biblically to make sure that, and I appreciate that about how you're studying the scriptures. But Paul he's basically just saying, when he says my gospel, I would say in comparison to others, this is what I'm preaching. And of course, this is the message of the cross, to which he would say, I'm not ashamed of it. And so this was the message that Paul was preaching. But he referred to it as my gospel. But in reality, of course, it was a gospel concerning Jesus Christ.
Hope that helps.
Okay. Okay, by you saying that, when a Mormon comes to my door with their gospel, should I accept that?
Well, no, because they have a different Jesus. Their Jesus is the half-brother of Lucifer, the devil. Now, we have to really understand this, because Paul warned about people preaching another gospel, another Jesus. The Bible tells us in the book of Matthew, chapter 1, that Jesus Christ is God. That's who he is. He shall be called Emmanuel, which translated means God with us. But when Mormons come along and they're preaching and they talk about Father and God in heaven and Jesus, it's not the same one. Do you realize when a Mormon prays and they say, we're going to pray to Father right now, they're praying to Adam who fell in the garden. That's right. Adam is the God of this world. Now that's in contrary to what the scripture tells us in Isaiah 44. The Bible says, I am God alone and besides me there is no other. But they believe in many gods. In fact, if you're a good Mormon, in good Mormon standing, you're sealed in the temple, tithe, do all the things you're supposed to do, you will progress into the third heaven where you will become a god yourself someday, propagate your own planet, and you will be God there. The Bible never teaches that, nor does the Book of Mormon. So these are ideas that come from somewhere else. And so when somebody says, the Mormon gospel, though they want to be considered another sect of Christianity, they have a completely different God and Jesus than Christians in general have. And we have to understand that. Now, many Mormons get mad at me and they go and ask their bishop and they go, oh, I didn't know that. And I've had many of them say to me, I don't believe that. So I said, well, good, there's hope. But if you believe you're going to be God yourself someday, that's the same lie that Adam and Eve were told in the garden by Lucifer. Eat of the tree, you'll be as God. And man has been falling and being duped ever since. That's why when Jesus taught us to pray, he said, Our Father, which art in heaven. Now, again, that means we're his children. And because we're his children, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. A little God doesn't, you're doing your own thing, man. That's the whole problem with a person that's not born again. They think they're God. I'm the master of my destiny. I'll do what I want to do. John, your thoughts.
Well, I think another thing to consider, why Paul mentions repeatedly, when he says the words, my gospel, there in Romans chapter 2, and other places, the reason why is you got to remember, Paul's ministry was constantly under attack. There were people who were always questioning what he was saying, why he was preaching it. They would say, Paul's not giving you the whole gospel. The Judaizers would come in and seek to undermine Paul's message. And so Paul is just emphasizing, hey, listen, you're questioning my gospel. You're questioning the good news that I'm preaching. And then he would back it up with facts. And he would point to Jesus. He'd point to his death. He'd point to his resurrection. So some of the reason why he says my gospel is because his apostleship was constantly being criticized and called into question. And so he was basically validating the gospel that he was preaching, that people were saying wasn't accurate. He said, listen, my gospel is accurate. And that's why there's that emphasis in that word that's used. He's not saying I'm preaching a different gospel to you. In fact, Paul will say, if somebody preaches a different gospel to you than the gospel that we're preaching, let him be accursed or anathema, cut off. And Paul makes that very clear. So that's another reason why we see that in the context there, William.
And William, the thing you have to, and we all have to understand, we don't go to heaven because we're good. We go to heaven because Jesus Christ is good. We're clothed in his righteousness. And that's what makes Christianity different than every other religion in the world. Every other religion of the world, you have to get out and prove how worthy you are. You got to bow five times to Mecca. You've got to baptizing in the temple for the dead. You have to sell flowers in airports. And you just might make it. Well, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says we have the assurance of salvation because only through Christianity, through Jesus Christ, are we reconciled to the Father and we're called his children. And children don't do anything to belong to their parent. They're just there. Once they accept daddy, hey, he's your daddy. Religions of the world never offer that. It's always a question. Are you worthy enough? Have you done enough? Have you given enough money? Have you knocked on enough doors? Have you done enough of the church's rituals to find yourself whether you're worthy or not? Where Jesus said, come unto me, all you are labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Rest from religion. Big difference. Hope that helps, William.
Yes, sir. It does.
Stay in line.
It confused me.
Yeah, I'll send you out some books and some DVDs I think you'll really, really enjoy. So you stay in line. We'll get those out to you. I think you'll be blessed. Let's go to Sarah, Dallas, Texas. Hi, welcome. Sarah, are you there? Looking for Sarah.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can, Sarah. Hi.
Hi, pastors. Hope you guys are doing well today.
You too. How may we help?
My question is in regard to Genesis chapter 1, verses 6 through 8, about the firmament over the heavens. I recently talked to a pastor at my church about it, and their answer just confused me a little bit more, so I was going to see what you guys, what your interpretation of that first passage would be.
Okay, John.
Well, the word firmament there comes actually from the Latin, and I do not speak Latin, but firmamentum, and it means sky or expanse. It's mentioned 17 times in the King James version of the Bible. It refers to the expanse or the heavens above. And you can see it in that nine of the occurrences of firmament are again, in the first chapter of the Bible, the verses that you mentioned. And the Lord talks about, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters. Let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament and so forth. And so it's just this whole understanding of the expanse of that. Again, the word sky is used. But one other passage that I would cross-reference to is that passage in Psalms 19, where it talks about, in Psalm 19, verse 1, it says that the heavens declare the glory of the Lord, and the firmament shows his handiwork. I mean, it just reveals his handiwork. The Bible says that God spans the universe with his hand. And so I think it's a reference to the sky and the expanse. Also, Psalm 150, verse 1 says, praise ye the Lord, praise him in the firmament of his power. So I think that's what it is in reference to. Of course, God's creation, but I think it's that vast expanse.
So I hope that helps.
Yeah, just for a little clarification, when it says it divides the waters from the waters, would your interpretation be that there's water outside of the sky or outside of the heavens?
Well, before the flood, there was. The Bible says that we were, that there was something around the earth, a vapor canopy around the earth. So the whole earth was like a greenhouse. It didn't have the violent weather swings as we get now. Any other thoughts, John?
Yeah, I think before the flood happened, you know, and when things just began, when it just from waters coming from with up, waters coming from up and waters coming down. I mean, that canopy that was there is no longer available. But I think when I think of the firmament, the sun, the moon, the stars, the expanse of the sky. So I think before the flood, there was water above. But ultimately, when I think of the firmament being created, I think of the vast expanse of sky.
Yeah, the Bible says it never rained up until the time of the flood, and the earth was watered by a mist. So very much like, personally, I think Hawaii. So just for what that's worth. Sarah, I hope that helps. I'll send you a DVD called God of Wonders. It'll answer a little bit more of this question for you. Say a line. We'll get you fixed up. John, thank you so much. Emily, call us. We'll put you on first thing tomorrow. So until then, God bless you and good night.
For about this ministry or to receive a copy of today's program, please call 1-800-357-4226 or write us to Every Man an Answer, P.O. Box 391, Twin Falls, Idaho, 83303. That toll-free number is 1-800-357-4226. Subscribe to the free podcast on iTunes by searching for To Every Man an Answer in the iTunes store or visit us online at csnradio.com/TEMA. To Every Man an Answer is a production of CSN International, the Christian Satellite Network. The opinions expressed by our guests may or may not be those of CSN International or of this station.